And now we will see the fourth pillar of organic farming. In brief, we tried to discuss about organic standards and certification and little bit of marketing network. The fourth component is practices of crop rotations, nutrient management, and managing the insect pests and diseases, which is part of the technology package. So in technology package, most of the things are similar to the conventional farming, but there are some changes in the crop rotations, nutrient management, and insect pest and disease management, mainly because we do not use any chemical or any pesticide here. Hence, we need to change the technology package of our production or processing. So this is a third important pillar. Fourth one is marketing network. Now I start with good agricultural practices. In general, I think you know what is good agricultural practices. It is the combination of the best of traditional methods and appropriate modern technology, balancing the economic production of crops with positive impact on the environment. So this is a general definition of good agricultural practices proposed by us long back in 2008 and 2010. It combines the best of traditional methods and appropriate modern technologies, balancing the economic production of crops with positive impact on the environment. So you can see that here is the combination of traditional methods and modern techniques, and also you get maximum economic return, and simultaneously you are protecting the environment. So that is what good agricultural practices leads to sustainability, leads to sustainable production. So in good agricultural practices, in conventional agriculture, you need to adopt crop rotations or crop diversification, which is a good agricultural practices. So here in organic farming, you need to give further more emphasis on crop rotations and crop diversification. In good agricultural practices, conventional farming, IPM, pest management, IDM, IWM, weed management, nutrient management, and so on. From these practices, if you put minus chemical and minus pesticide, then it becomes your good agricultural practice for organic farming. And here, by good agricultural practices, you get better crop production with minimum pollution of air, water, and soil. And each component of these components is associated with good agricultural practices, means related to IPM idea. Now, I have already told you about the core pillars of organic farming, standard technology package, certification market. So now we concentrate on technology package, means production. For us, it is production. For some, it may be processing also. So here, choice of crops and varieties. So there is somewhat difference in here, that here the emphasis is given on the choice of crops, which needs less input. Which need less input, and varieties which are tolerant to insect pests and diseases. So here, choice of crops and varieties is important. That is why I have shown you some niche area for crops. In one particular area, you can choose a particular crop. And also within a crop, you should choose the varieties which are insect pest and disease resistant. In the choice of crops, you need to see the local or adaptation of the crop, the market facility for the crop, whether you have sufficient market or not. Of course, same kind of things happens in case of conventional farming also, but here you give more emphasis on choice of crops and varieties. So this is also part of technology package. I will not go into the details, but I will show you some promising cropping system and promising crops for which technologies have been developed under organic production. Then, crop rotations. Now you have chosen the crops, now you want to rotate them. So you need to detail or you need to plan the crop rotations, whether you go for mixed farming or intercropping, where you will insert green manuring or legumes in the rotation. For success of organic farming, whether you are growing vegetables or food crops or cereal crops, whatever you are growing, inclusion of legume is very, very necessary. At least once in 2 years in a crop rotation, a legume should be there. Even if you are growing just vegetables, In vegetables, you can find some vegetables which are leguminous in nature. You can insert those in the rotations. So also, so is the case of green manuring, where you need to take legumes also. These legumes help in increasing the fertility of the soil, mainly nitrogen. They increase the availability of nitrogen. Then a third important technology package, or part of technology package, is related to sowing time. So normally there is no difference in sowing of organic crops and conventional crop. What is the ideal time for conventional crop sowing is the same for organic crops. So not much work has been done on this sowing time. The data is not available. So is the case of tillage operations. No research work has been done on tillage operations with respect to organic farming.
अजमल जी कट हो गए क्या?
हेलो सर,
सर तो लेफ्ट है,
मैसेज आया है सर का,
रिकॉर्डिंग स्टॉप कर दे।
इलेक्ट्रिसिटी
जो ऑपरेशंस फॉर ऑर्गेनिक फार्मिंग ओवर कन्वेंशनल फार्मिंग, सो दे आर द सेम। व्हाटएवर वे यू अडॉप्ट टू प्रिपेयर द फील्ड इन कन्वेंशनल फार्मिंग, सेम वे वी गो फॉर tillage operations in organic farming. So no change, no difference. However, some people are adopting a hybrid model, that is combining conservation agriculture with organic agriculture. In conservation agriculture, you have three major aspects. One is minimum tillage or zero tillage. Other is crop cover. You need to put your some kind of residues on the surface mulch, and you need to adopt crop rotations. So crop rotations are there in the organic also, they are common. And soil cover is not in organic farming. Whenever you use organic manures or crop residues, they are mixed in the soil. However, in conservation agriculture, they say that residues should be used as a mulch. That is the difference. Otherwise, this is known as conservation organic agriculture, a hybrid model, conservation organic agriculture. And one experiment has been started at National Organic Farming Research Institute, NOFRI, N-O-F-R-I. NOFRI is in Sikkim. Then comes your nutrient management. So nutrient management is somewhat different in organic farming than in conventional farming. Here your fertilizers, chemical fertilizers are not allowed. So I will like to discuss in detail how to manage nutrients in organic systems. And then weed, insect, pest and disease management I would discuss. It is a bit different from conventional farming. Now, just your rotation, crop rotations are common in conservation agriculture, even in conventional farming. Crop rotations are suggested for sustainability. So in organic farming, they got more role because you need to manage insect pests and diseases by crop rotations or prevent the infestation of insects or diseases in crops through rotations. Similarly, you need to manage the nutrients through crop rotations by including legumes in the rotation or green manure crops. So overall, you need to follow crop rotations here. And the basic purpose of crop rotation is to improve and maintain the good physical, chemical, and biological condition of the soil. By rotating the crop, by changing the crop, you are changing the above ground diversity and below ground diversity. Means crop rotation will help in the improvement of biodiversity all around. Reduce the soil erosion. In crop rotations, you will include leguminous crop, cover crops. They will protect your crops from erosion. And in these rotations, you have different rooting depth of different crops. So that way your soil structure is improved. And also there is addition of some extra organic matter in the soil by adopting crop rotations. Legume in rotation reduce the need for nitrogen fertilizer. It is very well known. For example, before rice cultivation, if you take green manuring of dhecha or sesbania, then you need to apply 60 kg nitrogen per hectare less in rice than no green manuring. And these crop rotations are definitely part of integrated pest management, weed management, nutrient management, or disease management. Therefore, crop rotations are important in any kind of farming or crop production. Now, in organic farming, why they become further more important? Because they enhance the productivity. To sustain the productivity, to improve the productivity, you need to follow the crop rotation. And crop rotations have their role in crop nutrition and soil health. Particularly if you take crops of different rooting their depth, then these crops can bring nutrients from deeper soil layer. Many times your nutrients get leased down to the lower layers of the soil. If you want to use those nutrients, which are practically useless by the shallow rooted crop, then this deep rooted crop will bring them to the surface into their roots. And then sometimes leaf fall or litter fall may be there. And that way crop nutrients, which were lying lower in the soil, they will come to the upper layer of the soil. So crop rotation, these rotations have very important role. And that way they maintain their soil health by adding organic matter and so on. Environmental protection. Because by adopting crop rotation, you can reduce the quantity of fertilizer. Quantity of fertilizer can be reduced, as I given you example. So that way your environment will be better if you go for crop rotations in organic farming, less pollution of the environment, less nitrate pollution of the groundwater. Insect pest disease management, they are also managed through the crop rotations. And economics, if you rotate the crop, your productivity is high, then your returns will be more. So crop rotations have a special significance in organic farming with respect to sustaining productivity, crop nutrition, environmental protection, management of problems, insect pests and disease, and economics. Now you see this case. See the title, diversification practices reduce organic to conventional yield gap. Means the yield was lower in conventional farming. But if you adopt the crop diversification, this gap can be narrowed. Means you will get more yield, increased yield, by diversification in organic farming. So two agricultural practices, that is diversification and multi-cropping. Multi-cropping means taking different kind of crops one after other in a year. Then and crop rotation substantially reduce the yield gap from 9 ± 4% and 8 ± 5%, or you can say 10%. Now see the diversified agroecosystem. If you diversify the cropping system, if you get different kind of crops, crops of different nature, means diverse crop rotations, and you have integrated crop, livestock also, and then cover crops and other crops. Here I wish to tell you that for the success of organic farming, farmers should keep animals. If you keep animals on the farm, then success of organic farming are quite high. As you know that you need organic manures for organic farming. So simple. And in organic manures, your crop residues are not enough unless they are composted. And crop residues cannot be easily composted. If these crop residues are mixed with cow dung or animal dung or urine, etc., their decomposition is fast and perfect. So you get more nutrients in farmyard manure than in crop residues. So livestock is very, very important for success of organic farming. So in diversified ecosystems or agroecosystem, you have diversified crop rotations, integrated livestock, means crop should be integrated with livestock. And then within crop, you can get cover crop, legume crop, or some other crops. So this is part of your diversified agroecosystem. Now we see the pros and cons of diversified ecosystems. Agroecosystem means plus and minus. So first see the plus of diversified agroecosystems. Improve soil organic matter. I think you understand how these crop rotations and having animals on your farm, cover crops, they will definitely improve the soil organic matter. Improve nutrient cycling. Mitigate greenhouse gas emissions, these crop rotations, reduce insect pest problems. So these are the general benefits of diversified agroecosystems. Now there are certain concerns, there are certain minuses of diversified agroecosystem. So it is more laborious. So at a time you need to manage two crops or three crops or two animals or two or three different kind of animals and their combinations. So it becomes more laborious. Challenges in adoptions, so you need to learn the technique of so many crops, so many animals and things. So they become challenges in adoption. Uncertainty is increased and high initial cost. So these are certain concerns of diversified agroecosystem, but you need to follow in organic farming these diversified agroecosystems for better returns in organic farming or for success of organic farming. Now, state-wise major crops grown under organic farming in India, both certified and in conversion period. So now state-wise, you can see what are the crops that are preferred, that are grown by the farmers. Arunachal Pradesh, it is maize, sorghum is organic. Andhra Pradesh, cotton, maize, pulses. Assam, tea, naturally tea is quite common, coffee, fruits and vegetables. And here I want to tell you that first time I tasted organic pineapple sometimes back, or rather long back, organic pineapple. I also tasted the conventional pineapple, but believe me, the taste and smell of that particular pineapple was so nice. I have never ever seen in conventional pineapple. And that is a brand from Meghalaya. There is one brand of pineapple which is now famous in many international markets. So those people have branded their pineapple and they are exporting in good quantities their pineapple from Meghalaya, which is organic pineapple. So I just could recall by seeing the name Assam. Now you see, so for Meghalaya, this pineapple is important. Chhattisgarh, rice, wheat, vegetables, Delhi, wheat, vegetables, and so on. Haryana, basmati rice. Jammu Kashmir spices, foods, saffron is quite important from Jammu. Karnataka cotton, rain-fed pulses, oil seeds. From Karnataka now ragi is being exported to Australia. So they make chapati of ragi, kacha chapati, not the pakka chapati, kacha chapati, and wrap it in some polythene, some covering, and then immediately export to Australia, and there they have market organic chapati or organic bread from millets, particularly ragi. Manipur spices, Maharashtra cotton, Madhya Pradesh soybean, and so on. So you can go through the list. Uttarakhand basmati rice is famous, Dehraduni basmati. And now regarding the technology package, remember we are dealing with technology package. In technology package, we are dealing with crop rotations and selection of crops. So just we have seen some list of crops. Now you see how best we can grow this crop. So this is the publication. If you want to know or see the detailed package of practices for organic production of crops in cropping system. If you are interested, how can I control weeds in sorghum, or how can I control pest of maize, how can I control diseases in rice, then you can see this publication. It is freely available on the website of Indian Institute of Farming System Research. So I just copied some slides. I made some slides from this book. This is a book or bulletin. From this book, I just copied some crop rotations for you. What kind of crop rotations have been recommended under organic farming? For example, for Chhattisgarh soybean chickpea. And for this soybean chickpea, they have developed the package of practices also. How to grow soybean, how to grow chickpea. So this is not just rotation only. You can find the package of practices for soybean, onions, rice, chickpea. So these are the rotations recommended for organic farming. For Himachal Pradesh, maize, garlic. Likewise for Kerala, some rotations are there. They are single crop, turmeric, ginger, black pepper, they are single crop. But now you can see intercrop like elephant foot yam, plus green manure cowpea, green manure cowpea yam plus green. So likewise, they are perennial crops, I think. Now, Madhya Pradesh, you can see soybean wheat, soybean mustard, etc. For Maharashtra, rice groundnut. So you can go through these rotations for different states. For Uttarakhand, for example, basmati rice, wheat, sesbania, basmati rice, lentil, sesbania, etc. Now you see the suggested cropping system, and if you want to go into the details of a package of practices for individual rotation, you can go through it. So these are already listed rotations for organic farming from Network Project on Organic Farming. So if you are interested, you can go through it. And technology package, I am not showing here, but you can consult that publication for the details. Now, nutrient management. This is the most important part of today's lecture, this lecture. And you can see that there are certain organic standards, as I told you. In organic standards, it is very well written or documented. What is seen on your screen, this is documented, that on organic farm, if you are managing the nutrients, sufficient biodegradable materials should be available on the farm. And it may include microbial preparations, plant or animal origin to be produced on farms. So biodegradable material here means manures. This is first principle of nutrient management. That means you need to keep animals, so simple, or you need to produce vermicompost or compost at your farm so that you need not to buy it from outside. There is no guarantee that you will get good quality compost or farmyard manure for your organic farm. So better to produce right at the farm. Number two, prevent nutrient losses. So this is common to all kind of crop production. You need to prevent the losses, prevent the entry of the pollutants. Pollutants should not come to your field, or heavy metal should not come to your field. So this is important. And then non-synthetic mineral fertilizers are not allowed. And biofertilizers are allowed. Non-synthetic mineral fertilizer are allowed, like your rock phosphate can be taken in raw form from the mines and it can be used. Gypsum can be used, sulfur can be used. These are non-synthetic mineral fertilizers. And some micronutrients are also available through the minerals, natural minerals, and biofertilizers to supplement nutrients. So these are the three important aspects of nutrient management. The fourth one is that desired soil pH level should be maintained. So this is the easiest way to improve your fertility of the soil. Just you make the pH right, then many of the nutrients will become automatically available. For example, if you have acidic soil, there is definitely deficiency of calcium, magnesium. So apply lime. If it is alkaline, pH is more than 8.5, go for gypsum. And gypsum will reduce your sodium content in those soils and it will ameliorate them. So you can correct the pH by natural materials like gypsum and lime. They are allowed in organic farming. Or one can use sulfur also to bring down the pH. So limitations are set for the total amount of biodegradable material brought onto the farm unit. Means certification agency will ask that how much of biodegradable material has been produced on your farm and how much you want to bring from outside. So company or certification agency will fix the limit that what proportion of biodegradable material you can bring from outside. Say 20% I can allow, 30% I can allow. So this is dependent upon the thinking or discretion of the certification agency, whether it allows or not, what percentage it can allow. Manures containing human excreta, feces or urine are not permitted at all. So there is fear that this human excreta or urine can spread some diseases. So therefore, they are prohibited. And further, it is also likely that they can have some heavy metals also. I think there may be some issues with heavy metals also in human excreta, because when they are collected from the urban places, urban centers, it gets mixed with some other substances also. So it is likely that human excreta may contain some heavy metals also. There was a case of cucumber death in death by cucumber in Germany. I don't remember the exact number of people, but many people died by eating cucumber. That cucumber was exported from Switzerland to Germany in 2011, and many people, maybe more than 300 people, died by eating the cucumber. So what happened? Some bacteria, Salmonella bacteria or E. coli, these kind of bacteria are harmful to human beings, and sometimes they can lead to the death of the people, Salmonella bacteria. So what happened? That cucumber contained Salmonella, and that Salmonella may have come from the immature compost used. So compost was blamed to transmit Salmonella into the cucumber, and then cucumber transmitted to human beings. So organic farming was blamed, that this organic farming resulted in the death of the people. So this can happen to the conventional farming also. If your manure is not matured, it is not well rotten, it has not passed the temperatures of 55 or 60 degrees centigrade, then it may contain some bacteria or viruses or some harmful organism. Because those students who have seen how FYM is prepared, during the preparation of FYM, particularly in the aerobic process, the heat generated is very high. And this heat temperature of the manure can go up to 60 degrees centigrade, at which all the organisms and weed seeds are killed. So similarly, in case of human excreta, it is likely sometimes that it cannot be digested completely, and then it can spread some diseases. Therefore, it is not allowed. Now, certain mineral fertilizers shall be applied in their natural composition. You mine them, mines are available, mine them, bring to the field, and you can do some physical alterations. You can reduce the size, but you cannot change the composition. You cannot add any chemical into them. They should be used in natural forms. So examples are basic slag, rock phosphate. But they should not contain heavy metals. Sometimes rock phosphate is known to contain certain heavy metals like cadmium. Cadmium can come from rock phosphate. So they should be tested for heavy metals. Products for use in fertilizing or soil conditioning. So overall, how this is exactly copied from the organic standards from India, Indian organic standard. I just copied from the book, and you can see matter produced on an organic farm unit. We just discussed biodegradable material to be produced on the farm. Matter produced outside the organic farm, that is also allowed, but with certain restrictions. Minerals are allowed, microbiological preparations are allowed. So only number two, that is matter produced outside the organic farm unit, have restricted use. They are not freely permitted. They will be decided by the certification agency whether to allow them or not to allow, or what proportion or what quantity of number two can be allowed. So here you will find three, four terms like permitted. Permitted means allowed. A product permitted means allowed in organic farming. Prohibited means not allowed. And restricted means that it will have restricted use. It may be allowed or it may not be allowed depending upon the discretion of the certification agency. Factory farming refers to the industrial management systems that are heavily reliant on veterinary and feed inputs not permitted in organic agriculture. Now, what matters are produced on an organic farm unit and that are permitted, like FIM produced on the organic farm, poultry manure, slurry, cow urine, crop residues, green manure, they all are allowed and they are permitted. Number two, matter produced outside the organic farm, like sawdust, wood shavings, you can bring and use. Prohibited item, human excreta. Restricted item means part of them can be used and decided by certification agency. Blood meal, meat meal, bone meal, feather meal without preservative. Compost made from any carbon-based residues, animal excrement, including poultry. So they have restricted use. Farmyard manure, slurry, cow urine, factory farming sources, not permitted. Means you can say on in very large scale, you can say at a very large scale. Fish and fish products without preservative, guano, restricted use. Byproducts from the food and textile industries, seaweed and seaweed products, sewage sludge and urban compost straw, they have a restricted use. They are not freely permitted. Vermicast, animal charcoal, compost, mushroom, compost from organic household, etc. They are restricted use. They have restricted use. Friends, see this picture. Do you know what is there in this picture? Can you tell me what is seen besides the plant? What you see in this picture, prominent thing?
Salt and debris.
Huh?
Salt deposition.
No. Salt deposition. No.
Cast. Yeah. Cast
of earthworm. So this is known as vermicast. So you can see this is in natural conditions, how these earthworms are doing their function. I took this picture from the organic soil. Organic soil. So you can see in organic soil, the earthworm activity is very high. So this is on the surface. They eat the soil and then they leave their excreta. So this is excreta from earthworms. Then minerals, permitted minerals are calcified seaweed, calcium chloride, calcium carbonate, sodium chloride, magnesium sulfate, gypsum, clay, etc. They are allowed, permitted. Restricted use, they are also minerals, but they have restricted use. Basic slag, calcareous magnesium rock, mineral potassium, natural phosphate. So these are mostly mined items from the mines. Microbiological preparations like bacterial preparation, biofertilizers, biodynamic preparations, plant preparation, and botanical extract, peat, etc., they are allowed. Now, what are the options? Because we are dealing with the nutrient management. So multiple sources are needed. No single source will be enough to make or to supply the nutrients. You need combination of sources. Or diverse sources. So all organic inputs do not uniformly supply the nutrient. That is the reason. If we take one kind of material and it decomposes slowly, so nutrient availability will be at a later part of the life. And if we take material which decomposes early or quickly, then it will finish too early. So we need a combination of sources that can supply nutrient constantly in sufficient quantity, particularly matching to the requirement of the crop. So you need combination of nutrient sources. The aim is to optimize the use of on-farm resources and minimize the losses. So you can see the inputs can be organic manures, crop residues, natural fertilizers, biological nitrogen fixation, irrigation water can also supply nutrients. I came to know that in Karnataka, there is one place where irrigation water contains sufficient amount of potassium. So farmers do not need to add potassium to their soil if they are using irrigation water in that particular area of Karnataka. So it is there that some nutrients can come from irrigation water also. Atmospheric deposition also contributes for the nutrients. Then output or losses can be from crop harvest, erosion, leaching, gaseous losses, and from weeds. So these are input output of nutrients in any system. Now, sources of nutrient can be organic source, on-farm sources, and off-farm sources. So on-farm sources, you can see the list, crop rotation, farmyard manure, all these can be produced on the farm. And some sources can be brought from outside, like your coir pith, press mud. Press mud is from sugarcane factories, oil cakes, biocompost, sewage and sillage, etc. So these are the major sources to supply nutrients in organic farming. This is the list. And then oil cakes are also important because they are quick releaser of nutrients. They release nutrients quickly. So you can see these oil cakes, particularly neem cake, is important because it is non-edible. It is not eaten by human beings by animals. So it finds its use in soil. So on an average, you can see, I just taken the average value of all the oil cakes listed here. So on an average, oil cake contain 4.9 to 5% nitrogen. Please remember this value. At least you can remember 5%. So 5% nitrogen, at least 5% nitrogen is there in all oil cakes. And phosphorus P2O5 1.6 to 1.8%, and potassium K2O 1.4 to 1.5%. So this is the general composition of oil seeds. And some oil seeds like your neem cake, oil seed cake, I'm referring to oil seed cake. So neem cake can be advantageous in the sense that it can control some soil-borne insect also. So it is, and also it has got some fungicidal properties, this neem cake. So it can, some extent, it can reduce the incidence of insect pests and diseases also. So there may be certain constraints of nutrient management in organic systems. First is limitation of organic manures in large amounts. To supply 1 kg nitrogen from farmyard manure, you need 200 kilogram. So if requirement is 60 kg nitrogen, then you will need huge quantity of manure. That is a limitation. Other limitation is slow release of nutrients, particularly in winter. I have shown you that yields of winter crop is low in northern India. And it was after 6th or 7th year even, 10% less yield of winter crop was obtained. Wheat produces 10% less yield even after 7th year of cycle or 10 year of cycle. So mainly because of slow decomposition of organic matter, the nutrient supply is affected, and which results in lower yield of winter crops in northern India under organic system. Farmyard manure, there can be losses during collection from the shed, cattle shed, storage in the heap or in the ditch or gadda, whatever you call. Storage and application losses are there. Losses may happen at the time of application by volatilization or by irrigation water. Difficulties in adoption of diversified rotations, problems of including legumes in rotation. So farmers also know the benefits of legume crops, but many times they are not able to include the legume crops. In certain areas where legume crops were grown, now farmers have abandoned those crops, mainly because of wild animals. For example, in this western Uttar Pradesh, I know many farmers were growing chickpea or sweet pea or green pea. These are the legumes, but now they have stopped growing legumes because of the blue bull, Nilgai. Nilgai is an animal, wild animal, that loves to eat the legumes. So because of wild animals, some farmers, or rather large number of farmers, have stopped growing chickpea, lentil, or your sweet pea in western Uttar Pradesh. So there are number of problems related to legumes in rotation. Other problems can be related to rainfall. If you are growing your legumes in the kharif season, so suppose some farmer have sown their legume in July, 15th of July. Now across the India, we had so much of rain, you know, some places flood is coming. So these flood can damage these legumes more than rice or any other crop. So because of this, now farmers have started sowing these black gram and green gram. Ideal time of sowing has been recommended around 10 to 15 July. But in practical sense, farmers are growing these legumes in the month of August, from 1st to 15 August. If you have gone to any village, you will find that this is the time of sowing for black gram and green gram. Late after the rainfall, they try to avoid the main or major rainfall so that minimum damage is done to leguminous crop by the flooding or by water logging. Matching the nutrient requirement versus demand, it is very difficult, easier said than done. Quantity of nutrient sources to be used is huge. Then nutrient combinations, farmers do not know what is the ideal combination. So here we need to do some research to find out the best combination of nutrients depending upon the kind of sources available in different localities or different climates or different soils. Immature manure should never be used. Biofertilizers effectiveness or biofertilizers are sometimes doubtful. I told you they give you inconsistent results. In 1 year, you will get response to biofertilizer. In another year, you may not get any response. So their response is not fixed. Then you will require some fertilizer, otherwise your crop will suffer. Here, not fertilizer, some other nutrients sources. Sometimes cost of organic sources of nutrients is too high, like vermicompost. And sometimes there may be non-scientific thinking like zero budget natural farming. It is not scientific thinking, and such kind of farming can never be successful. So summary of nutrient management: health of soil is linked to health of the plant, and you can go through it. So after nutrient management, you get tools or components of organic insect pest management. Just 10 minutes more. So now I think most of you know about it, pest management. These are approaches of integrated pest management. Here you do not take just pesticides. If you remove the insecticide or pesticide from the list, then remaining methods or remaining practices, if they are combined, it becomes your integrated pest management in organic farming. In organic farming. So most of you might have studied all these ecology of pest, how you can control or prevent the pest. Pest surveillance, ETL, host plant resistant, behavioral method. So these are techniques to control or prevent the insect pest disease. Physical methods, mechanical methods, cultural methods also include your crop diversification, and certain biological methods like botanicals or biopesticides, predators, your parasitoids, pathogens, etc. Some biological control method. Cultural method, mechanical method, physical method. Only your chemical methods are missing. So in place of chemical methods, we can have these biopesticides. Biopesticides like neem can be. So this is how we can go for organic pest management. And pest management practices, tools and practices suggested by Silaba. From FAO 2002, manipulation of crop rotations to minimize survival of crop-specific pest. strip cropping moderates spreading of pest over large area. This is very common practice where you can grow two different crops in strips. So this is a good method of controlling or managing insect pests. Manipulation of pH level and moisture level. Some disease happen in soil at a particular pH. Like fungi, they normally dominate in acidic pH. So if you have acidic pH, you may have some pH-related disease caused by fungi in certain crops. Similarly, if you have high pH where bacteria prefer, so in those conditions, you can have some bacterial diseases in a specific crop. So under those conditions, if you manipulate the pH, if you lower or make it higher, so one can avoid certain diseases also by manipulating the soil pH. Similarly, certain disease may get more effect when you get too much of moist conditions, and other way around, it may be your too dry conditions. So ideal moisture can be maintained. I will not go into these details because I assume that you must have studied some courses on plant pathology. Manipulation of planting dates, early or late. For example, sorghum shoot fly. If you plant early, then sorghum shoot fly will come. If you delay the planting of sorghum, it will not come or it will not have very devastating effect. So we can manipulate the planting date so that it does not suit to the insect pest, to plant at a time most optimal for crop and least beneficial for the pest. So this is very simple approach. Adjustment of seeding rates to achieve the optimum plant population. Sometimes it has been found that overpopulation causes more infestation of insect pests and diseases. Similarly, lower population also. So we need to optimize the population. And plant varieties we can select which are insect pest and disease resistant. Biological control methods can be adopted. Traps can be used, possibly with the use of lures such as pheromones, sanitation, deep plowing. So many cultural practices, removal of weeds, etc. And pesticides can be used, biopesticides like botanicals, rotenone, neem, pyrethrum. This Bacillus thuringiensis in natural form, it is allowed. Pheromones are allowed, minerals are allowed. So some materials can be used, like, you know, copper sulfate, if it is from natural source, copper sulfate can be used to control some fungal diseases, I think it can be used. So there are some options. Now, this is the best option, and I ask you to learn this. This is very important, push and pull for stem borer striga control. So just I was discussing someday about ecological engineering. Ecological engineering means there are certain engineers, there are certain living things in the ecosystem which are doing the job like we do in artificial systems as our engineering. So they are engineers in the ecology. So this is known as push and pull for stem borer and striga control. So in this case, you can see that this maize, sorghum and pearl millet, these three crops are affected by stem borer and striga. Stem borer is an insect which enter into the stem, the larvae or the caterpillar, you can call it larvae or caterpillar. It enters into the stem after hatching from the egg and then it eats the stem from inside. So your maize or sorghum stem will be damaged and plant will stop growing. So this is very damaging pest, insect pest of sorghum, pearl millet and maize. So stem borer. Another problem is your striga. So striga is a semi-root parasite. It lives on the roots of maize, sorghum or pearl millet. And it gets minerals and water from the maize plant or sorghum plant, which is a host plant. And it has got, striga has got some leaves and it can do little bit of photosynthesis. It can make food, but for some nutrition, it depends upon the host. So by this way, striga can reduce the yield and performance of the maize and sorghum. So both these pests are very dangerous. And these pests can be controlled by push and pull system. Push and pull system, in this system, you need to do the intercropping of maize with Desmodium. So, and on the boundary, you can plant Napier grass. So just in the picture, you can see that on the extreme left and extreme right, it is Napier grass. So it is on the boundary of the field, all along the boundary of the field, you need to plant the Napier grass. Napier grass is your Penicetum purpureum. It is known as Hathi grass or elephant grass. So on the boundary, it is elephant grass. And in the main field, you have intercropping of Desmodium in the rows of maize, sorghum, or pulp millet. So in the, suppose one row is for maize, another row is for Desmodium, and next row is for maize, another for Desmodium. So Desmodium is a fodder plant, which is leguminous in nature, leguminous fodder plant, and maize is a cereal plant. So what happens, this adult of the insect stem borer, the adults will lay down the eggs on the leaves of the maize, and then these eggs will hatch and enter the hatch into the larvae and enter the stem. But what happened, this Desmodium will release certain volatile compounds into the air, and that will push the adult male and female away from the maize plant. It will push, it will throw them out. You have no place, because it is releasing certain volatile compounds into the air, which will push this insect away from the maize plant. Then on the boundary, you have got this Napier grass. It also releases some volatile compounds into the air, and it will attract the adults, male and female, towards it. So now the adult will lay down, the female will lay down eggs on the Napier grass. And then Napier grass has a characteristics that it is, its volatile compound will kill the eggs of this insect stem borer. So eggs are killed by Napier grass. Adults are thrown away. They are pushed back away from the maize plant, and they are pulled by the Napier grass, where they are giving their eggs, laying down eggs, and these eggs are killed by the leaves of the Napier grass, releasing volatile compounds. So this is how this, the life cycle of the insect is broken. Here the life cycle is broken. So you will not have any damage to maize crop or sorghum crop by insect, this insect, stem borer. Now, Striga, roots of the Desmodium will release certain chemicals, or you can call them root exudates, and they will kill this Striga. It will kill the Striga plant. So therefore, you can see Striga weed is killed. Your insect is also killed, or their life cycle is broken for stem borer, and everybody is happy. And in the end, you can harvest Napier grass for fodder purpose. It is a perennial fodder plant. So if you want to know more, just you go to the Google, and in Google, you just type push and pull theory of stem borer and Striga, or just type push and pull. Push and pull, you will get lot of pages, lot of research paper. And this practice is quite common in Africa. In many African countries, these millets like maize, sorghum are quite common, and they are adopting this method in larger area. And this was developed in Kenya, International Center for Insect Physiology and Ecology. So you can see it. So likewise, Our entomologists or plant protection scientists should work on this line, just identify such kind of system, such kind of ecological engineering, so that we can manage the insect pests and diseases or weeds free of charge and in an environmentally friendly way. So now weed management in organic crops. So there are lots of options for weed management in organic crop also. And we should avoid herbicide because of these reasons. And this slide, weed management in organic crops. So here also you got integrated weed management minus chemicals. So I'll not go into the details, because many of you might have studied weed management in your BSc agriculture or in MSc also. Some of you might be having this course. So eco-friendly weed management, there are different approaches. Certain preventive strategies are there. Preventive strategies are there. Cut the weed infested crop prior to weed seed production. So you can go through all these. Physical methods are there, tillage and conservation agriculture, hand weeding, moving, grazing, mulching. So I took most of these slides from my friend Dr. T.K. Das. So if you are interested, I can get one lecture from him on ecological weed management, means weed management in organic farming. So you can tell me if you are interested. If he has taken such lecture, then no need to ask him again. But he will be the better person to speak on this. Cultural strategies are also there, crop rotations, plant competition, crop establishment. I think agronomy students, they must have studied it. And resource conservation technology also reduces some weed incidence. There are different RCTs like broadbed furrow system or some minimum tillage, zero tillage like this. You can see on the right side, it is broadbed. So bed is broader. It is having four rows of wheat and some residues of cotton. This is cotton wheat system from Dr. T.K. Das. And on the left side, you can see narrow bed plus residues. So here you have three rows of wheat. And in between, they have spread the residues of cotton. So this kind of system also reduces weed. So if we can take it into organic, then it is likely that we can reduce the weeds in organic systems. And zero tillage, what is the role of zero tillage? You can see in weed management. This picture, again, I borrowed from Dr. T.K. Das, a nice crop of wheat. But problem may come in Kharif season. In winter season, wheat growth is slow and their numbers are also less. So this is your, on the right side is chickpea under zero tillage and mustard under zero tillage. So if it is replicated in organic system, then it has a promise to reduce the weeds, these kind of techniques. And this is cropping practice, crop diversification. Crop diversification means change of crop rotations also help in reducing the weed. I can give you one classical example. In rice wheat rotation, you get too much of Felis minor in wheat. So you need to change for 1 or 2 years. In place of wheat, if you grow Bursim, just for 1 year or 2 years, this Felis minor will go away from the rotation. So such kind of practices, change in crop rotation can control the weeds. And this is maize plus cowpea, means just kind of cover crop, intercropping system, you get less weed. So in organic system, this intercropping with legume is useful in reducing the weed incidence. And soil solarization is a practice. It also helps in the weed management. And rice residue left after rice harvest. So you can see in the wheat crop. So good scope, it looks to be good scope, these residues, water hyacinth mulching potato, trash mulching for Striga management in sugar cane. So Striga also damages sugar cane. So allelopathic effect of crops on weeds. So this is by rotation or by intercropping, one can manipulate this allelopathy also in organic system to control the weeds. I don't have much idea of this subject, but it can be useful. Certain bioagents are also available, but they do not find any practical use for weed management in field condition. They are for the sake of, I think, competitive exams for the students. Bioherbicides, again, same problem. So finally, you can see that the technology packages for different crops, soils and climates are evolving. We do not have yet the complete package for different climatic condition, different soil. So it is definitely required. It is a researchable issue. Nutrient, weed, insect pest and disease management are the most important issues. These are still limitations. I have discussed a lot, but when we go to field, sometimes it becomes difficult to control the insect pest and disease under organic systems. Crop diversification and rotations play a very important role. I have discussed in detail how these crop rotations are important for management of insect pest disease, weeds, etc. Diversified options are available for the management of nutrients. We need to combine different nutrient sources. There is need to develop cultivation packages for different crops. And thank you very much. I welcome your questions. So you are free to interact, and recording can be stopped.